people sing, singing the song of angry men. It is the music of a people who will not be slaves again. When the beating of your heart echoes the beating of the drums, there is a life about to start when tomorrow comes.
I love doing this because every time you eat and invite me to do something like this, then you're forcing me to think about different things and do research. And the best way to learn about something is to present it, right? Because then you have to find all the logical holes that you have and so on. And so it's very interesting because basically the way I like to work, or the way I work, is that I have an insight or I have a hinge on an idea that I think that is true, right? And then what this does is this forces me to formalize it and find all the holes on it and put it together and make something useful out of it. So thank you for the opportunity, Pat. I hope this is useful. And let's start.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So basically, when Ita said that if I wanted to talk to you again, guys, I was thinking, and this is an idea that has been going around my head for actually some years now, and I thought this was a perfect opportunity to put it together. So let's see how it goes. Can you go to the... So what you see there is the goddess Risa, and this is a depiction of an allegory of reason created at the time of the French Revolution. And what I'm going to show you is the story of the modern story of this goddess. And in order to start this story, we have to go somewhere arbitrary backwards in time. So let's go to the medieval times. And can you advance, Ethan, to the next slide, number two? What I want to do is imagine that we go backwards in time to the year 1300 or 1350 or 1400 or 1250, because for that matter, humanity stayed very stagnant for a long, long time, and things seem to be the same for a long time, right? So, but imagine that we were able to go backwards in time to that time. And what you're gonna see, right, is that we are living in a feudal society. We don't have electricity. We don't have, like, this miracle of what we're doing now, this kind of communications around the world instantaneously. And imagine how the world is at that time. So you have an incredible social difference. You have the serfs, the peasants working the fields, the land, and around the feudal castles. And you have these lords and these princes and these kings who live in the castles, who are usually illiterate. And then you have the clergy. And between the clergy and the princes, right, and the lords, they have absolute power over everything. And that's the world, right? It's a very primitive world in where the majority of people live in poverty, and a very few people have power and control the lives of everybody else. So can you advance next? The other thing that you have at that time is a lot of superstition and a lot of fear. Imagine that, right? Like, so the population, the majority of people are illiterate. They don't know anything, right? They know how to work the fields or how to do their day-to-day jobs, but that's it. They don't know how to read and write. And their mentality, right, the way they think, they have this mystical thinking way that is completely superstitious, and then it's full of fear, and they believe in sin, and imagine these very heavy Catholic ideas on top of them, and all this punishment in hell. But it's not only that, right? At the end of the 1200, right, the Inquisition is there, and what they do is everybody who questions the authority of the church is burn at a stake or torture, right? So this image of hell that you see here is quite real and tangible, because that's what happens to people who question the status quo at the time. But then along with this comes something that is the age of reason and the age of the Enlightenment and the Renaissance. And this is what I want to explore with you, but I want to give you this. So think about this. Think about this world, right? Like, imagine yourself, put yourself at that time, and imagine that you can belong to 3-4 different classes here, right? You're either a peasant, or you're a merchant, or you're part of the clergy, or you're the nobility. But the majority of the people live in poverty, right? And at the end, the only ones who know how to read and write are the people from the clergy, and some merchants, because they have to, right? They have to do accounting and things like that. So what I want to show you is, out of that context, what happened and what took us to the age of reason and the Enlightenment, right? So you can imagine the first thing, and it's not here, but one of the things, right, in 1454, right, Gutenberg came out with the first printed Bible. Now, this is unbelievable. Imagine this. It's a world where everything that is written down is manuscripts, right? So a book is very precious, and hence is very rare. So, and most people are illiterate. But when Gutenberg creates the printing press, all of a sudden, there is something that can make possible and affordable to everybody to get the written word. So this technological advance is the one that makes possible for people to get literate, because absent that, books are too expensive anyway, and ideas, the propagation of ideas is too slow. So this is a crucial moment in time, right? And this comes at the time of the beginning of the Renaissance. Now, the other thing that you have at the same time, right, is Marcello Ficino bringing all the books from Greek and from Greece and Rome into Italy, and they start to get translated into new languages, right? So from Greek. So imagine this. So what you start having is this inflow of information. Now, the other thing that is interesting about the publication of the Bible is that, if you think about it, all of a sudden, the Bible is in the hands of people, so people can start reading the Bible. And what this does, right, is that now you can start reading for yourself what before was passed to you, and now you can start reading it on your own, and you can question it. So let's just start moving in time, right, a little bit, and then in 1492, what you have is the discovery of America by Christopher Columbus, and all of a sudden, the center of the world is not Europe anymore, but the world is bigger than what people expect it to be. And now you have all these unknown lands that people thought it was India, right, but it comes a time of discovery and questioning your own traditions and what your preconceptions of the world. Now in 1517, you have Martin Luther, right, which, thanks to Gutenberg and thanks to people being able to read the Bible, right, and thanks to all the excess of the members of the Catholic Church, right, then all of a sudden you start to have, imagine a dam, you start having little cracks, right, and the status quo is starting to be questioned, and the vision of the world that you have based on superstition and the authority of the church starts to break down. Now, the next thing that you have, right, and this comes in 1543, right, is Copernicus coming with a heliocentric view of the world. So think about what this does to the psyche of people. All of a sudden, this dogma that you have, this idea that the world is the center of the world, out of the universe, right? But more important than that, that the ideas of the church are being questioned. And all of a sudden, you start having alternative possibilities. So immediately, when you start having alternatives, you start to think about different ways to think things, right? Now, the next one that you have there, 1616, is William Harvey discovering how the circulatory system in the body works and seeing how the heart pumps blood and discovering that in some way we're not these magical beings, but we're this mechanical system, right, that is pumping the blood through the vessels and so on. And this is one of the important moments, right? 1618, you have Kepler, Johannes Kepler, where he gives his laws in numbers, right, of the movement of the sun around the earth around the sun, right, and the laws of Kepler. All of a sudden, what you're doing is you're systematizing and you're giving numerical formulas to the study or the movement of the stars. So all of a sudden, what you're doing is you're formalizing and you're able to predict with a mathematical way nature. And then comes next, right? Like the triangular stamp there that you see, right? That's Galileo. He dares to take a telescope and again, thanks to technology, right? And look at the stars, and all of a sudden he can see the moons of Jupiter, or Saturn was, and he starts to confirm that the ideas of Copernicus are correct. And imagine this, so what you start having is this erosion of the dogmas of the past, and a new way of looking at the world starts to show up, right? Then the next one you have there is René Descartes, and then you start having, these are all the philosophers of the Enlightenment, right? And what he gives you is basically, he proposes the scientific method. So here is where a new systematic way of approaching, of learning and getting knowledge starts to get on. Next, the next one you have there is Thomas Hobbes with the Leviathan. And then in 1687, what you have is Sir Isaac Newton with the Principia Mathematica. And this is the beginning of modern physics. Now, things are not separate. Everything is related, right? So imagine this. When you get this, when you go to the machine, right, the printing press technology, and then you get the trips of Christopher Columbus, and these ideas of physics, but everything is interconnected in a way or another, and is connected also to questioning the status quo, and hence politics, right, and the organization of the state, and the idea that you have this supreme authority, who is the king, right, or the pope, right? You start questioning all this, and then in the line there, so in 1733, you have Voltaire, right, and he starts to criticize criticizing the government of France, and at this time, people, you already can publish things, so your ideas, you can spread them in mass, right? 1748, you have Montesquieu, and the ideas of the spirit of laws, right? And then in 1751, the next one, that's Denis Diderot, who wrote the encyclopedia, right? And he was kicked out of France for doing this. 1762, you have Rousseau, Jean-Jacques Rousseau. 1781, you have Kant. And 1789, you have the French Revolution. So it's like a dam that starts to have cracks, and all of a sudden, in 1789, what you get is a rupture, where everything breaks down, and what you have is a change in history, and that's a point of fracture where the old institutions collapse, right? And you have a new system. What you see there, the French Revolution is not only a political revolution, but it was an ideological and a sociological revolution. And this is what happened, and this is very interesting. What you see there is a depiction. So the French, what they decided was to abolish everything that was part of the past. So what they did is that they declared, or they started something that was the process of de-Christianization of France. And part of that was that they took the idea of reason and they elevated reason to the status of God. And they created literally this image of the goddess of reason. And this is a depiction of what happened at the time on the streets of Paris and France in general, right? They basically took a woman and dressed her allegorically, and she represents reason, and they start to do processions on the streets behind reason and sharing reason. So here is an image of that, right? Let's move to the next one, slide number 6. Here you have another depiction of the goddess reason, the goddess of reason. Now, notice her foot with the red shoe is stepping on top of Jesus Christ. So you see, this is an allegory that the new goddess, the new system, the new cult, and it was called the cult of reason, right, is superseding the old cult. It's stepping on the old cult. Now, move to the next one.
Next one, next slide.
Do you see the temple of reason?
Yep.
Yeah. So what they did is, on every church of France, they start redeclaring, right? They threw down the Christianity, right, and Catholicism, and they remade all the temples to become the temples of reason. And this is what is depicted there, or this is a picture, I think this is Notre Dame, and just you can still see that there, where basically they rebranded all the temples to the new cult, which was the cult of reason. So they elevated the idea of reason, right, and the rational mind, and the idea of enlightenment to the level of God. Can you see now Moses with the commandments?
Yeah.
The Decalogue. Now, on the right hand side, what you have is the Declaration of the Rights of Man and the Citizen from 1789. But do you see the resemblance? What they did is they are creating a new cult. They are taking, in a way, it's very interesting, right? Because they're taking down the old paradigm and the old beliefs, but in a way, still the same, because they're taking the same symbolism and they're rebranding it. They're rewriting with new symbolism on top of what they had before. So you can see the old Decalogue becomes the laws of man and the citizen. And this is important, right? Because what you're going to see is that democracy and the modern state, right, the nation state, is a replacement for the old idea of God. And I'll show you how that works. Now, this is very interesting, because one of the raptures and one of the ideas of establishing the new system of reason was the imposition of the metric system. And this is from the same time, right? This is, I think this was instituted on 1793. So what you see here, look at this clock. Now, it has something very peculiar, and this is a clock from the time, right? The face of a clock from the time. So look at how many numbers you have there. So it doesn't have 12 numbers, it has 10 numbers. So they decided to recreate, right, and get a break from the past and institute something completely in their minds rational. So what they did is they introduced the system of 10, of counting 10, and they decided to substitute all the system that they had before with this. And part of that was to create this system, right, which had 10 hours, and every hour had 100 minutes. And they start running with this time. And the other thing that they did, right, is that before, they used to measure things And the same thing with the system of docents, right? And if you think about it, this idea of the watch of the clock with 10 hours is absurd. It doesn't work. And it doesn't work because the number 10 is not a good system to measure things. And it's arbitrary. It's it could be 10 or it could be 20 or it could be whatever. But it's 10. But the problem with 10 is that it doesn't have too many dividers. So you can divide 10 by 2 and by 5. Now, the beauty of the system of 12 is that you can divide it by 4, by 3, and by 2. So that gives you the ability to have quarters and have thirds, because a third of 12 is 4, right, and a quarter is 3, which are complete numbers, whole numbers. A third of 10 is a monstrosity, because it's 3.333333 forever. So to count things, right, if you're in a market and you're buying things, right, and I want half a dozen or a quarter of a dozen, makes way more sense than the decimal system. Now, what is interesting about this, right, is that it has obvious advantages to use a system of 12, but they decided and forced the system of 10. And these 3 or 4 years later, people were desperate with the idea of the 10-hour day and so on, and it collapsed. And when Napoleon came to power, the first thing that he got rid of was the decimal hour. Now, in terms of other things on the metric system, think about this. Temperature is measured in the metric system. Zero is the point of freezing of water. So what they did is they took an absolute reference independent from human beings, and all the measurement is built around that, right? Now, if you look at the Fahrenheit system, it's from 0 to 100 is the temperature where human beings can live comfortably or where life can happen, right? Between 0 degrees and between and 100. So that's all these measurements, right? Feet, Fahrenheit, the clock, the 12-hour clock, all these things are referential to the body, to humans. When you start doing this, what you're doing is you're taking an ideal, that is a number, right? You're taking reason, and what you're doing is you're giving it absolute value, and that's reflected in the metric system. So you see how these ideas of the godless reason that we're looking before, right, and taking this woman and putting it on a pedestal and giving it this status of a goddess, is just an allegory to this. This is another aspect of the same thing. So part of the Christianization was also to rename the calendar and break from the calendar from the past. So again, obsessed with this idea of the decimal system and 10, what they decided right at the beginning, they were trying to do 10 months, but they couldn't make it fit. So they settled for 12 months. Each month had 30 days. And then each month had 30 days divided in 3 weeks of 10 days each. And they decided to rename the months, right, to break from the past and all these loaded ideas on the names of the months. And they made references to things in nature. So what you see there, like the first column, right, is autumn. And by the way, the calendar started basically in autumn. At the equinox of the 1792, at the equinox, which has an allegorical connotation, the equinox is one of the 2 days of the year where the length of the night and the day is the same. Equi equals nox, night. So night and day the same. So it was an allegory of equalité, equality, which was one of the precepts of the French Revolution. If you remember, it was liberté, fraternité, égalité, et fraternité. So it was a way to start, and they declared that the new age started 22nd of September of 1792, and that was year one in this new calendar. Part of the calendar also was to break the week, because before, if you imagine, France used to be a deeply religious country. And this was part political, right? Because what you're doing is you're doing this change, this political change, and the church has a lot of power and a lot of economic power. At the time, they were the owners of a third of the land in France, so they were depossessed of the land. But another aspect of this, right, is that people used to worship and go to churches on Sundays. By doing this, what you do is you have now 3 weeks. The concept of Sunday disappeared. You don't have a Sunday anymore. You have one day, which is called the Décadi, every 9 days, which is a free day, and is a holiday and a free day to celebrate freedom and the revolution. So what happens, right, is that when people, you're not supposed to work on Sundays, but when this happened, right, and people say, no, I'm not going to work on Sunday, and it falls on one of the days of the new week, then people were forced to work on that day, or the other way around, right? So people were forced to rest on the 10th day of the week. This also failed miserably, and we obviously, you see today, we were back on the old system. The other thing that they have is that if you think about it, they have 12 months of 30 days each. That's 360 days. So that didn't match up with the cycles of the Earth around the Sun. So they have to institute 5 floating days, right, every year at the end, which were holidays, to catch up the 365 days of the year. And these days were consecrated to reason. And then on leap years, they had one more day, which was consecrated to the revolution. And curiously enough, right, trying to move forward, what they did was that they end up replicating the ancient Egyptian calendar, which is the same as the calendar Republican. So it's very interesting when you start seeing how all these things are related and everything makes sense in this context, right? Okay? So this is the cover page of L'Encyclopédie of Denis de Diderot, right? Which was this book, which was one of the first modern encyclopedias. Now, what you see here is an allegory of reason. So the central image that you see there, right, the radiant woman, naked, right, with this little veil, semi-translucent veil, that's truth. And then the woman with the crown, that's reason. And then underneath, what you have is all the arts and sciences. So what you see is that the radiant, the light of truth, is percolating everything, and you see the crown of reason, right? So she is the king now, she is the top, and everything goes underneath.